Yes, the relay on YouTube. Check it out. Lots of stories about me on there. All the boxing facts and info that you want in a very entertaining, educational manner. The relay. Check it out on YouTube.
Welcome to the motherfucking relay, where we're covering today's top boxing news.
Okay, we'll start with this. A continuation to the story I touched on in my previous video. Hearn seeks repayment of training expenses. Serrano responds. Yesterday, we were notified by our promoter, Lou DiBella, that Eddie Hearn wants that $10,000 back tomorrow, Friday, July 3rd at 5 p.m., explained Jordan Maldonado, manager and head trainer of the record-setting 7-division titleist. He seems not to care that we trained not only from March till May.
You trained from March till May.
Where'd you do that while the entire city of New York was closed?
From March till May.
But also for his rescheduled date of July 4th, another date where he canceled without an accurate explanation.
Accurate explanation? What's this guy living under a rock?
Coronavirus!
Did you forget?
Coronavirus!
Travel restrictions widespread throughout the entire planet. Restrictions from the British Boxing Board of Control.
This guy's a shyster.
And this shyster was quoted as saying, now, because we didn't accept his offer after the July 4th cancellation of taking a purse deduction and a change of venue to literally fight in his backyard at one of his homes, he's being disrespectful and vindictive.
No, you're being a waffler and are in breach of contract.
Amanda Serrano was quoted as saying, I've lost two lucrative opportunities to fight in an MMA match and another to participate in the Exelaton competition waiting for Katie Taylor.
You were never waiting for Katie Taylor.
As soon as fight dates ended up getting postponed and rescheduled, you tried to double book yourself.
That's what you did.
And you're not at liberty to do that because you're under contract. The fight dates were postponed because of issues on their side, not ours. And now I'm to blame? Signing with Matchroom Boxing has been stagnant in my career because I debuted with them in January of 2019, made history, and I didn't fight again until September. We just asked for respect. Respect and transparency.
Oh, you want transparency? Here's transparency.
Weren't you set to retire from the sport of boxing in 2018? Had the people over there at Matchroom not made you that 3-fight deal, where would your career be now? The career you claim they're stagnating. Eddie Hearn was quoted as saying, subject to them coming on this week and saying, fair is fair, we'll take the fight, there's still time. I like the Delphine Persoon fight. We've made 3 offers to Delphine Persoon. It's close. It's close. It's a bigger fight because of the controversy from the Feist fight. Katie wants to take that fight because there is doubt in some people's minds that she won that fight. So now, it's a fight like all these fights in the world that deserves sold-out crowds in an arena. But we don't live in that world anymore. If you're a fighter, if you care about legacy and achievement, you have to adapt to this environment. You have to go for it. Taylor wants Persoon. She wants Serrano. She wants Breakheads. She wants Cyborg. I'm not saying she's done after that, but that's what motivates her. When you look at the world, the only thing I can guarantee Katie Taylor if we can get Persoon over the line is we can do it now. Can we do it in October or November? I don't know. But I know we've got a slot in August. I think she'll be up for it. It's clear that Serrano is no longer up for anything Matchroom related. Amanda Serrano was quoted as saying, I've read from many that Mr. Hearn was a horrible person. Now I know firsthand he's actually worse than that. I'm a firm believer in God, and I know he doesn't like ugly. To my island and my fans, I love you, and I promise our island is resilient, and I'll be back.
Yeah, whatever.
I don't know if by the time this video is uploaded, a conclusive answer will come from the Serrano team as far as what's next. Will they balk? Will they decide to have the fight even though they clearly don't want it? Or will they run the risk of being sued for the $10,000 fronted to them by Eddie Hearn?
We'll see.
But I have to say this. If Amanda Serrano is about anything at this point, Amanda Serrano is all about the pity party. Because that's what she's throwing herself. Mean old Eddie Hearn wants his money back. But why? It's because you guys are refusing to honor the contract. It's because you guys are refusing to fight Katie Taylor in the Matchroom fight camp at a time where you're not at liberty to make that call. You signed on the dotted line, which empowered Matchroom to not only set the date, but reset the date if need be. And you're not keeping up your end of the bargain. That's why he wants his $10,000 back, because he paid you $10,000 to train for Katie Taylor.
Prendo.
For a Katie Taylor fight. A Katie Taylor fight that you don't want to have in August.
Okay, so give the man his money back.
I think, given everything that has already been said, and everything that has already been published. If Amanda Serrano were to go forward with the fight at this point, it would be from a feeling of being forced into the situation as opposed to genuinely wanting to. That's why I don't even think she deserves this fight. That's why I've been saying the whole fucking time, cut her loose, let her go, bon voyage. Because if Amanda Serrano is about anything at this point, she's all about the pity party. Poor me. Eddie Hearn wants his $10,000 back. Hey, I got a question. If Eddie Hearn is every bit the monster that you say he is, why was he the one fronting you $10,000 to train in the first fucking place? You got a promoter. His name's Lou DiBella. Why didn't the money come from him?
Why did it come from Eddie?
If Eddie Hearn is every inch the mean man, the monster that you say he is, why was he the one flipping the bill for what are your training expenses? Amanda Serrano's got the audacity to say that the people at Matchroom caused her career to stagnate. Hey, newsflash, according to you, your boxing career was all but over in 2018. That was supposed to be your last year. So to what career are you referring to? Your fledgling mixed martial arts career? Oh, cause fighting Deanna Santana, who you beat already in the squared circle, fighting her in the octagon, that's much bigger than fighting Katie Taylor, right? They're holding up your big fight in Combate Americas with Deanna Santana, who you fucking beat already in 2017. Amanda Serrano and Jorge Maldonado are little more than two con artists, two shysters throwing themselves a pity party and playing themselves the violin. But let me tell you something, sweetheart. This the big leagues. This the big times. This ain't Fordham fucking Row.
Right?
These little shyster tactics of yours, they're not fooling anybody. We've got an extensive itemized list of excuses that you've used to get out of this fight. I mean, what are you trying to convince me of exactly? What are you trying to convince me of? That you were free to participate in Xlatan, okay? You were cool. You were on board with that. But you're not on board to fight Katie Taylor on August 22nd. You keep bringing up a goddamn price reduction as if there is a price reduction when Katie Taylor decided to make up the difference of what would have been a price reduction for Amanda. So stop talking to me about price reductions. Your own promoter already said there's not going to be a price reduction. So that's no excuse for you to balk. That's no excuse for you to back out of this fight. And they don't want to have the fight on Eddie Hearn's lawn. They don't want to have the fight without a crowd present. Hey, listen, if anybody's suffering the consequences of there not being a crowd present, it's Eddie Hearn. You needn't concern yourself with that because you'd be having the fight for the original money agreed upon.
The live gate ain't your problem.
Excuse after excuse, violin solo after violin solo. And now what they've resorted to is vilifying Eddie Hearn for wanting back on his investment. Well, he only invested in you on the premise that you'd fight Katie. And you're saying you don't want to fight Katie. Not in August.
Okay, then give him his money back.
Because the idea that you and Jordan blew through $10,000 from March till May or June or whatever it was at a time when most of the country shut down. Yeah, nobody's buying that. You guys are trying to double dip. You're trying to keep the 10 he already gave you and ask for an additional 10.
Yeah, in all likelihood.
I say, go for a clean break. I say, cut her loose and let her go.
It's ridiculous.
She's just wasting everybody's goddamn time. Stevie Wonder could take his shades off and squint and see that Amanda don't want this fight. Everybody can see that Amanda don't want this fight. In welterweight news, welterweight contender Butaev's manager is quoted as saying, it's possible that Butaev winds up fighting Ugas for the WBA title. For those of you out there not already familiar with the varying grotesqueries of the story, the 26-year-old welterweight contender from Kasavyurt, Russia, who now fights out of Brooklyn, New York, was forced to wait 7 months for justice stemming from a vacant title fight loss to countryman Alexander Besputin last November. The initially declared unanimous decision was cast in shame after Besputin tested positive for the banned substance Ligandrol. He's quoted as saying, I hope that the WBA will issue their resolution on this situation and announce my opponent for the world title soon. Insists Butaev, who has not fought since the aforementioned clash with Besputin in Monte Carlo. I am ready to go. I will fight anybody. It doesn't matter to me. I just want my fair and clean chance to achieve my lifelong dream of becoming a world champion. The secondary version of the WBA title that was at stake, Manny Pacquiao was the sanctioning body's super champion at welterweight, we all know, is now back in play as a result of the concluded investigation. The next step will be for the loss to be scrubbed clean from Butaev's record while he waits for word on his next potential opponent for, once again, the vacant title. We are in discussions for that, notes Kornilov. It's very possible that we wind up fighting Jordanis Ugas. He is the current number one contender and is always willing to fight anyone. We are fine with fighting Ugas or anybody else for the world title, Kornilov insists. Now, if you're sitting where Butaev is sitting, and you got no American profile, nobody here knows who you are, you're pretty much up for anything with anyone. Even a high-risk, low-reward guy like a Jordanis Ugas, who, as odd as this might sound, has more of a profile here than Butaev does. And Ugas, he ain't got the biggest profile, but whatever he's got, it's more than Butaev's got. So Butaev's going to be open to a situation like that. He's open to that kind of a fight for the WBA's regular title.
That's why.
For Ugas, however, you have to wonder why this is a more attractive option. You have to wonder why he's even considering fighting for what is a vacant secondary title. There is the Manny Pacquiao angle to consider, that perhaps Ugas and his team view this title fight, should they win it, as a segue for a Pacquiao fight, that at some point perhaps the WBA would order it. But
it's not very likely.
That's the thing. That even if that's the angle they're approaching this situation from, it's still not very probable that the WBA would order such a fight or that Manny Pacquiao would go through with it. It's possible, but not very probable or plausible. The fuck's Manny Pacquiao need with a Jordanis Ugas? So there has to be some other reason that the Ugas people are actually receptive to fighting for this version of the title, this situation. And the only other angle that I can think of is, you know what, maybe the Ugas people aren't expecting to get a Pacquiao fight. Maybe they're expecting the exact opposite. Maybe what they're thinking is, we're going to position ourselves,
now.
We're going to be in line,
now.
Get ourselves in line to collect the full version of the title. Perhaps not from Manny Pacquiao, but should the day come that Manny Pacquiao finally retires, that super title's going to go vacant. And we want to be in line to grab it when that happens. Perhaps that's why they're going with this course of action instead of prioritizing a Terence Crawford fight. It's a bit of a contingency, it is. Right now, we don't know that Manny Pacquiao still is on the PBC side of things, but what we do know is that Ugas is lining himself up for his belt. So if the day comes that Manny retires and he vacates it, Ugas will be right there to snag it and keep it on the PBC side of things, thereby satisfying the requisites of their island policy. People over there at the PBC might be telling themselves, why send our guy Ugas over there to ESPN to potentially lose to Terence Crawford when we can keep him right here, have him fight Butaev, and line himself up for that belt?
Manny's.
He certainly got a better chance of beating Butaev than he does of beating Crawford. That's what I think is going on, because the idea of prioritizing a secondary title as opposed to fighting a world champion for a major one, there's got to be some hierarchy of thought there. There's got to be some rhyme, some reason that they're doing this, and this is the only reason that I can think of. It is the path of least resistance, but it does save us that Pipus. And finally, Ryan Garcia was very recently quoted as saying that who he really wants is Gervonta Davis. And I've expressed a previous sentiment in the past that I actually like the pressure that Ryan is putting on Gervonta Davis, because even if it doesn't materialize in a fight, which we all know it won't,
nope.
Gervonta Davis is effectively isolated from most anyone else with any other outfit anywhere from 130 to 135. Those are the facts. Ryan's mentions of Gervonta bring this harsh reality to light, that for all of Leonard Ellerbe's hyperbole about how Gervonta Davis is a superstar and a pay-per-view attraction, the reality of it is there's no substance to those claims. Their idea of a major fight for Gervonta Davis is having him fight a featherweight who just moved up to super featherweight at a time when Gervonta just moved up to lightweight.
It's fucking stupid.
So I don't actually mind that Ryan is in many ways shaming Gervonta Davis for how his career is being navigated, how his career is being guided. I don't mind that. But what I want to see from Ryan here and now is...
Along with shaming Javante.
I'd like for Ryan to keep that same energy, that same enthusiasm for Luke Campbell. Luke Campbell, who he has been ordered to fight very recently by the World Boxing Council. Luke Campbell, who's all for the fight, thinks he has everything it takes to knock Ryan Garcia out and went as far as warning Ryan Garcia that that social media following Ryan's always bragging about, they won't help him in the ring. I think for what it's worth, Ryan Garcia's social media following is a good foundation, a good base, and a good platform to launch his career into the next stratosphere. Do realize that there are more people aware of Ryan Garcia than there are other fighters who are further along in their careers.
People know him.
So Ryan is on the right track, but a part of being on the right track,
especially for an up-and-comer,
is staying within the public's good graces, not being derailed by becoming a social pariah amongst the boxing fans, the boxing community. Ryan has an order before him.
Mm-hmm.
He has to fight Luke Campbell to advance in the WBC's ranked standings if he is interested in becoming their world champion at 135 pounds. Because right now, their world champion is Devin Haney. It's very difficult for someone in Ryan Garcia's position to become a world champion in a weight class as competitive as the lightweight division, because in the lightweight division, you've got anybody from Vasyl Lomachenko to Teofimo Lopez to Devin Haney, Luke Campbell, Jorge Linares, Javier Fortuna. There's a lot of guys here, past and present, that are dangerous fights for a kid like Ryan. Believe it or not, his best bet at becoming a world champion would be to go through Devin Haney, because he got no shot against somebody as experienced as a Vasyl Lomachenko. I mean, that's why you never hear those two guys' names in the same fucking sentence. Nobody's expecting Ryan to go that route. And I'm not telling you that I think Ryan here today has what it takes to beat Devin, so much as, relatively speaking, you've got a better shot against Devin than you got against Lomachenko. And you can't keep cycling around on the outskirts of the upper echelon fighters hoping to get somewhere. You're going to have to take on some difficult fights. You're going to have to take on guys like Luke Campbell, a more maturated, experienced fighter than Ryan Garcia is, both as an amateur and a professional. But that is a necessary evil. And in this chapter of Ryan Garcia's career, these are the kinds of challenges that he'll be entering into. How will he meet them? I haven't heard anything from Ryan as far as how he views that Luke Campbell fight. Who knows if we will hear something from him by the time this video is uploaded. But if he is to cross over into the next stratosphere, he's got to keep the same energy. You got to keep the same energy for a Javante Davis, who we all know they aren't going to let him fight you. You got to keep that same energy for a Luke Campbell. Now, Ryan, he's talking about coming back in August or September, maybe even December. Something major. Who knows? And if you want to have the kind of fights that people care about, you got to take on those kinds of guys. You got to take on those kinds of challenges, because that's what's going to keep you in the good graces of the boxing community and allow your stock to grow.
You gotta take risks.
Nothing ventured, nothing gained. If you're trying to convince the world that you're here today ready for a fight with the likes of a Javante Davis, for example, who you've been calling out, then there's no reason a Luke Campbell fight should bother you. If you're ready for Javante, you should be ready for Luke.
We're gonna find out if Ryan actually is.